and Echo Fox's jungler.
Thank you very much. I'm here with Arcadian, moving back from the back line, re into the front line. I have to ask you just quickly, how is it to kind of be back in the squad and playing again?
I don't really look at it like that, like off the team or something like that. We're really all a team, like the whole 10, you know? So Greg got a chance to play last week, and I was rooting for him the whole time. And I don't know. I mean, it's just really up to the coaching staff what we do. And I mean, it was fun. I love playing LCS. It's really, really fun and exciting.
And I have to say, I agree with you. It is definitely more of a full 10-man roster thing. So let me ask you, what's it kind of been like having another jungler there? Do you guys have different styles? Are you learning off each other? Is the other guy like researching matchups? What does that two jungler system sort of look like?
I mean, it's great. We have our own way to practice, I guess. We have our own way to go through scrims all the time. And it just allows us to do things that other teams really can't do. Because you have, like, if you're scrimming another team, you have to respect them, right? Or you have to like respect that they want to get practice out of it too. But if you're really just a 10-man roster, then you can practice, you know, whatever you want, and you can control what you're playing against too. So it's good.
Makes sense there. And my final question, you have another opponent this weekend. Hopefully, of course, looking to go 2-0 for the team, but Dignitas will be our next opponent. And they also actually have two junglers that they've been using pretty actively in Chaser and Shrimp. What do you think about both your potential jungle opponents there?
I mean, I've played against both guys many times. I really think right now it's less about, you know, playing. It's not really about like playing the matchup against the jungler you're playing against or something. I don't think there's anybody that you look at and you're just like, oh man, you know, I'm going to get smashed. It's more just about playing with your team. So I think if we just have good team synergy, we should be able to 2-0 again.
Well, so far so good. Congratulations on the victory today. Arcadian, thank you very much for the interview. Now back to the analyst desk to end out the day.
Thank you, Pastry Tom. Echo Fox picking up a victory here tonight, making our second 2-0 on the evening. Very quick evening at that. Well, let's look at how they put this together, because a completely new look for them in game two from game one, going triple ADC with the Nidalee behind it. And then the Thresh is really their only primary engage outside of Verisult.
Absolutely. And as Azale was saying during the game, fully committing to this strategy super early. There were no questions about where people were going with Kennen, Lucian, and Varus all locked in the first phase. So at that point, Team Envy could have technically done whatever they wanted, if they wanted a huge tank line, if they wanted a bunch of people who could stack armor. So I actually really have to say Envy failed the end of their draft to be able to counter exactly what Echo Fox wanted to throw at them.
Yes.
But then you credit Echo Fox for going ahead with a strategy that they really wanted to play before the game and just kind of forcing it through champ select and making it work.
Yeah, draft mistakes and in-game mistakes over here. Very interesting. Committed draft, and hey, they followed through on the commitment, and that's what matters when it all comes down to it. But the lead that was required, you know, in order to push this kind of a team comp forward actually came from a player that has suffered a lot of criticism throughout his career and even in these early weeks here. Keith, coming up big with a few key Varus ultimates. Let's take a look at the first one. 11 minutes into the game, off of a beautiful swap to the top lane and counter gank here on Lyra.
And the Ken and Jace matchup is very swingy, so being able to avoid and land the ganks is huge. The Mist ultimate by Lyra is huge, but then where did Keith and Gate come from? They had recalled, they decided to do the swap. The timing is perfect. It turns around multiple kills for them in the top lane, gives them priority over that top lane, helps get Looper ahead, helps keep Seraph behind, but it was perfect accuracy there from Keith on the ult.
Exactly. No turrets go down after that, but two go very low. We'll see them knock those down later in the game, and that's what kind of established that 2K gold lead that they were able to play with in order to keep control and keep pressure on the map. And now I want to go to a very interesting mechanical play, and I'm just going to step back and let you explain this. This is 17:30 into the game. Keith with a beautiful ult flash.
I was actually absolutely blown away by this play, because at first it looks like, oh, he just ulted them as Varus, but this is not a flash ult. This is an ult flash. The ordering of the skills is very important here. So think about where his mouse has to be. He has to press his ultimate on the Victor, then move his mouse to flash a very difficult wall and still get it out. You do not have time to move your mouse to flash that wall after that play, which is why that is probably the best Varus ult I've ever seen.
Yeah. I mean, again, I just want everyone to take a moment, breathe that in, maybe rewind, watch it five more times, and then go into the practice tool and give it
also
a shot yourself.
I need to see if it's actually hard, because I think it should be. I think it should be super hard, but I'm definitely trying that out.
At least he's going to the same side of the screen in both directions. But even so, that is two distinctly different mouse positions within milliseconds in order to pull that off. So hats off to Keith there in terms of, again, being the main initiator in both of those plays early on. That that did gather them that goal lead where they could, okay, now we can control the map, control the pace of the game, and hand things over to Looper. Yeah. And this is where we get to Looper as
then they
player
actually
of the
had
game.
To play the rest of the game.
Exactly. So we've got the lead. Now how do we win it? Looper was a big hand in that, receiving player of the game for the split push. I mean, you flip the matchup. Now he's on Kennen, right, into Seraph, who had played it the game before, and he just styles on him there in the side lanes.
Yeah, Looper, back-to-back player of the games in this series. Punishing the Death Dance, funnily enough, from Seraph.
That was hilarious to watch.
Death Dance is not damage reduced. It is damage deferred, and Seraph would continue to die as he walked away from fights.
He's like, I've got 10%. I'm going to flash out of this duel. Oh, wait. Yeah. There's 10% of my health left to be done.
Contrast Looper's Kennen with Seraph's Kennen in the game before. Not just from how he played it, but also in the tools the enemy had to play against it, right?
Right.
There was a Pantheon in the casting that could run down Seraph in game one. There wasn't the same for Echo Fox here, but this is when you got to see kind of the power of the pick. They got a lead. They never allowed the map to shrink, and Looper always expanded that map and pushed home huge advantages.
Absolutely. Now, all this said, of course, within both teams, we can talk about mistakes. For Echo Fox, there was still a number of skill shots not hitting that probably would have allowed them to close the game out cleaner in some of their engagements. Yep. Let's flip over to Envy, though, for a moment, because at the beginning of the day, we looked at the standings. We're talking about parity. We're talking about a team that's made a big surge up through the standings in Envy as compared to the spring split. Well, here they come in and they get 2-0'd today. So what is our kind of, let's take a moment, give them a new report card. What did you feel was maybe missing in their games today that we have seen from them in the last 2 weeks, and or what do you want to see more of as the weekend unfolds?
Yeah, it's true. We talk about parity. Both of them are now 3-2, so we're good on that.
Parity!
But I thought they lacked flexibility or the right sense of purpose, because I felt like their drafts were pretty poor today, and they were not super complex drafts that they needed to pick around. I know the Pantheon caught them by surprise, but in the second game, they knew exactly what was going to come at them. And then when you're starting with a bad hand, so to speak, even if you want to play a slow macro game, you will have a slow macro game with an inferior strategy, and that's not going to work, especially if they lose that wild style they had last year. So get back to finding a win condition and sticking with it.
And can I throw out one piece of individual criticism? If you are basically the sole tank on a team that's going into triple ADC,
and do build not, the right items.
Do not build Spirit Visage as your first tank item to follow a Runic Echoes and then follow that with a Merc Tread.
Then Die Dilution built Ninja Tabi on the fountain and said, wait a minute, maybe that 1 second cannon stun should be reduced by 25%. No, build the Ninja Tabi against the three auto attackers, dude.
And look, built that. And look, this is us criticizing Lyra, who was first team all NA last split. The guy is clearly a very solid jungler, but even those tiny things can make massive differences, and we've seen it all the way up to the world stage where runes, masteries, or just your item builds can really turn the table. So it's those kinds of things that we are still going to harp on. But you talk about parity, let's see how the standings have shifted after today's games. Immortals maintain their spot at the top with the win over Team Liquid, while Echo Fox bump up to fourth place after taking down Team Envy. Meet us back here tomorrow for more league action. It all starts with Reignover and Team Liquid versus Haunxer and TSM on NALCS1, followed by FlyQuest taking on CounterLogic Gaming later in the day. Now, if you're watching on NALCS2, Immortals take to the stage against Cloud9, and then Phoenix 1 hope to pick up their first win against Team Dignitas. It's crazy that I am saying that. Within those four series tomorrow, we've got a couple big ones. What's the one you got your eye on?
Yeah, I mean, I actually want to see Phoenix 1 and if they've rejiggered their roster a little bit to try and find some success, because that's a team that finished third, was on this big upward trajectory. I want to see what happens.
Well, you want to see, with their rejiggled roster or possibility of rejiggling, they're up against Dignitas. So at the beginning of the day, we were talking about all the different roster possibilities
I want to see the new players.
That could be a really fun series if we had swaps in and out. Well, we'll have to wait and see. For myself, the casters, and the entire live broadcast crew, thank you all for watching. We'll see you here tomorrow for more North American LCS. Good night.
We're about to embark in our first series of the day as the Immortals take on Team Liquid.
Cody Sun very low. That might even kill him right off the W.
Brent Fever pick. Oh my god, Olay! That was a disgustingly good flash.
Just got me.
Oh, nice. We got him. Nice.
Oh. Nice.
Flamey wants a solo kill grab. He's gonna proc. Flame takes down Lolo. And now the turret's going down. Golden Blue evaporates. Vital number two is up. There's three. Lolo looking for the first button. And he's gonna grab it. Olay still speeding forward. Lolo through the turret. Riposte is good. Duncan gets the stun onto Flame. Ace in the hole, not enough. And now it's Mitty gonna make it happen. Pybelta shuts it all down.
We're sailing the seven seas straight towards our second game of NALCS for the night. Players prepare on stage.
for Team Envy versus Nexus Fox. Oh, here we go. But the fight's breaking out. The Pantheon's coming down. Glacial Fissure out to block off four, but the stuns come through. Rune down onto Lyra, who is immediately shut down.
Go, 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 go. Go, kill, kill. Before. Go, kill Aki.
I'm gonna base.
Woo! Let's go, baby.
Push.
See what he can find as Keith, of all people, shows up in the top lane to turn this around. And Echo Fox finds two.
Lyra makes his way over.
He's already dead. Froggen gonna be taken low. GA pop. Lyra trying to escape. The spear finds its way onto Furion. Apollo grabbing the kill onto Froggen. Furion on the one. The Nexus falls. And Fox goes 2-0.